on the phone. We had one of my favorite players of all time back in the 84, 85 when I turned on the Bears games. I would turn it on just to watch this guy play linebacker. Former Chicago Bear, Washington Redskin. He also played for the Oilers and the Cardinals. Wilber Marshall. How are you doing today, Wilber?
I'm doing great.
I see that you grew up in Florida. How did you end up choosing Florida University for college?
When you grow up here, that's just a part of it. That's where you go. It's a great school, great people here.
Were there any other schools recruiting you back then?
Yeah, I had all of them. I had all the colleges. I went everywhere. I had them all recruit me back then.
Was Florida State an option at any point?
Sort of. I had a friend at where we grew up. There's a lot of people. We go to Florida. Florida State. We're like not too far from either one of them. So it was one of those things. But at that time, they had a problem with Sims, and those guys had definitely had the stealing of radios and all that stuff came up. So. That was one of the reasons why I wasn't going there.
Your coach at that time, that was before Spurrier. Who was it back then?
Excuse me?
Who was your coach at Florida back then?
I was Charlie Pell.
What was Charlie Pell like to play for?
He was a great guy. Good motivator, good recruiter. Things just didn't work out for him.
Now, you came in being a parade All-American in high school. Did they have high, how high were the expectations among the Gators staff and the fans when you entered the university?
Well, back then, I don't know. It's a small town that I'm coming in, and I played just about every position in high school. So I wasn't sure exactly what they wanted me to do. I know I played tight end, and then the next month that I was put on the other side of the ball.
Was there any consideration of putting you on offense when you were at Florida?
I did my first year, played it, and then we didn't have that many players. You know, we started out really slow with Charlie coming over from Clemson. Florida wasn't winning very much, and put a group of guys together, a lot of great guys. And both of us had to play a lot of different positions, like James Jones. We both came in as tight end and moved him to fullback. Mike Malarkey, that, you know, coaches now, he played tight end. They left him there. We had three of us there playing that same position, and another guy called Faulkner. So, they left those two, Mike and Faulkner, there, and then they moved James Jones to fullback, and I went to the other side. Had a lot of good athletes that played both ways.
Did you have a preference one way or the other, offense or defense?
At the time, I wanted to play offense, but at the time, you know, we had four tight ends. Okay. At that time, you just want to play. You want to be on the field. You don't want to be sitting behind someone. That's what I have a hard time with these kids now, that they go to school and they realize, you know, they're the top of their game when they come out of high school. But when you get to that next level, you just want to get on the field. And you should think that instead of sitting behind someone, and who knows what you could have been, you know?
Was there someone you patted yourself after as a linebacker when you were in college?
Excuse me?
Is there someone you patted yourself after in college as a linebacker?
No, not really. Not at that time. I was just glad to be on the field playing. And he put me in a situation where, with my speed and size, that I could play outside linebacker. It's like now, in the NFL, you're playing a 3-4 compared to a 4-3. You're rusher. Now, you're basically a defensive end. They move to an outside linebacker position, and you just make all the sacks. That's how I got to where I was, to the next level, because I could come off the edge. But Freddie had other ideas on how he wanted to play his defense into a 4-3, and not a lot of people did that, and they moved me behind the line of scrimmage, so it was a lot tougher to get those sacks and make those plays.
In college, was there a point where you said, hey, this is pretty easy, because you had a lot of success? and, you know, nationally recognized? Or do you think it would be more of a challenge?
When you're playing this, in college, you know, I'm telling you, it's just fun. You're just playing. It's not like today, you know, everybody looking for that next step.
Yeah.
We're just glad to be there, glad to be playing. And all of a sudden, you know, that got to my last year. They go, man, you're going to want to be one of the top players coming out. I mean, what do you mean? You know, what do you mean, guys? So you're going to be the top player. You're going to be one of the guys in the first round that's going to be coming out. And you're going to make it. And that's what happened.
Was there a game that stood out as your favorite one in college?
Oh boy, there's a lot of, we had a lot of rivalry games played against Georgia and Auburn, and I mean it was very tough. Every game was tough, but the USC game when they came in and they had a great game, that's how I got basically put on the map, you know, running down to the old student body.
I mean, you probably didn't enjoy going against Georgia with Herschel Walker back then.
Yeah, we had a lot of great, you know, I mean, it was a lot of great players, you know. Bo came in a little later from Auburn, and it was bad. He had Brooks, Auburn. We had a lot of great ball players that we had to go through the SEC. You had to play against every week. There wasn't just one team. And then Florida State, our rivals, and then Miami. We played a very tough schedule.
After you graduated, did you know the Bears were going to be drafting you, or you were looking for somebody to take you quicker? What was your anticipation heading into the draft?
Well, in the draft, it was a lot. I was supposed to be the first pick in the draft, the way it worked out. And because of the Houston, I had a couple picks. And but what they wanted to do, they wanted to keep two players. They wanted to get a lineman. I think his name was Steinkuhler at that time. I think that's what his name was. And at the time, they figured that, yeah, wanted to drop me down. And so they didn't take both of us. If they took me first, then they wouldn't have got him. So they wanted to make a deal with me to sit back in this way. And so what they did was they basically tried to outprice me to the other teams. And by doing that, no one would touch me with that. At the time, the Bears were, you know, hey, well, that, you know, we'll take our chances. So they never got a chance to get that other pick.
Was there any temptation to go to the rival league, the USFL?
That was part of my bargaining agreement. I mean, with, you know, against the NFL, that's what you want to do. But I told them, I just want to play in the NFL. I wasn't worried about that. I think the Tampa Bay Bandits drafted me, and I didn't want to go there. I just wanted to play in the on Sundays, coming home from school and from work, working with my father, coming when we watched the Miami Dolphins, just wanted to play ball. I wanted to play the NFL, and that was it.
When the Bears drafted you, what went through your mind? It's a little colder in Chicago than it is in Gainesville.
Well, one of this game was my hometown, a little small place in Titusville, Florida. The games were even bigger, and that was scared to death where I'm going. Saw the tall buildings and, you know, how it's going to go. I never, you know, had to take care of myself. Everything was done. You know, mom come do your laundry and, you know, place to eat, place to sleep, and you had school. And now I had to go in this, to me, big and fast world of Chicago and try to fit in.
Because when you joined the Bears, that defense was pretty much on the rise. You had Singletary at middle linebacker, Otis, and you had L. Harris at the other linebacker. Did you think to yourself, you know what, this might be a little tough to break the starting lineup?
No, not for me, because what I believe myself, I believe I could play. And I think that's the difference. You don't go in there thinking that I am going to, you know, can't break anything. I knew that I could run. I was faster. I know I can play the game. And if you're going to be a first-round pick, I know that's what they wanted. They weren't going to be sitting there waiting for me to break the lineup. They're going to put me in the game, and let's see what I'm going to do. And that's what they do with all the first-round and young players now. You got to earn that money. Otherwise, they don't look good.
What was your first meeting with Buddy?
Oh, it was tough. It was difficult, Buddy. You know, it's just red highway. This is how it's going to be done. We don't play, you know, young guys, because you don't know the defense. You got to know it inside out. And that's a tough part of playing with him, because playing for him, that you couldn't make mistakes. He had a chart, and we had to take tests every, you know, every week. If you were going to be on the field, you had to score out 100 on that test, or you weren't going out on the field.
How long did it take for Buddy to figure out what your name was? Because I heard he called everybody by their numbers.
All these great defensive teams, because, you know, he demanded them, everybody knowing what everybody else is supposed to do. Like myself, I have to know what the safeties and I have to know what the corners are doing. So if someone screwed up, I can be able to take their place. If I see them supposed to be somewhere else, you know, you slide over and you take their position, because that's a part of that defense. You had to know everybody's positions.
So did you ever end up in Buddy Ryan's doghouse?
My first year, because I wanted to play, and he said, no, that's his doghouse. He wasn't going to let it happen. He said, you got to learn it. You got to know it. You know, by towards, end of the year, I knew it, but, you know, that's what he decided he was going to do. You have to learn this. You have to pick these certain defense up. You know, play special team. This is what he can do. I think they said he did it to everyone else. So when they told me that, I just expected that. Kept my head down and just worked hard.
Who was the leader of that defense when you joined them? Was it Singletary? Was it Hampton or Fensick?
Oh, they had a lot of leaders. Depends on who was on the field at that time. Because the way we did it, we had automatic fronts, and a lot of things that a lot of the other team doesn't do. Is that we, our defense depend on formations. And at that time, we could basically call, Fitz would call it in the back on if they got to run a cover two or cover three, or they got man. And then linebackers have to know what the corners are doing, what the safety's doing, because sometimes you play together on the in and out of it, we call it slice. So you have to know exactly what they're doing with the middle, with the linebackers. And then Mike will call calls from the line, and that's what's going to shift the defense. That's why a lot of time when you saw our defensive front shift from one defense to the other, we knew exactly what we were running. And we can shift defense when everybody line up into it. The quarterback come up to read. We're allowed to change the defense. But even though our safeties and corner know exactly what we call from the sideline, and Buddy would give us that automatic front signal, and we know exactly if they get into a split back or a strong formation or two receiver on one side. Hope I'm not getting too much over your head with this stuff, but that's just how we did things. We had to know exactly what everybody's doing. That's what I said earlier. We had to know exactly, because we called that front. That's what he wanted.
At what point did the defense know that it was just as dominating a defense as the NFL had seen?
My second year, during camp, it was just fun. It wasn't really, you know, working. You know, guys, you know, knew their role, knew exactly what we were going to do, and it became a lot of fun where, you know, guys are saying they're going to be the first one to get the sack, or this is what we're going to do. And plus, if you know the defense well enough, like we did, and I think that's the reason why Buddy had us know everybody's position, even the linemen. Even the linebackers, because we have to know what gap they're hitting and know what backside to play. And if you knew that, you could always compensate. And at some time, Buddy allow us to do that in the game, where you come to the sideline and we go, hey, Buddy, I can beat this guy. Let's just go, I can do this. And we're in a 4-3, I'm on the end of the line. I'll just tell Richard, hey, move outside, I'll play behind you in a stack position, and I'll let you go ahead and rest this guy. If you can get there, get there. And if it doesn't work, everybody said, then, you know, never run it again. So that's how he let us play it and had fun with the game.
I still don't get that Dolphin game in 85, how you lost that game. Was it just Dan Marino knew how to pick apart that defense, or was it just bad game planning by Mike Ditka?
Well, there's a lot of stuff that happened that game. Jim McMahon didn't play, one. They had Fuller in the game. And at that time, you know, we were just, you know, trying to play a game. I don't think anybody knew that we were trying to break a record at that time. I know I didn't, but I was just playing. I was just trying to do the best I could. And we had a lot of people, like Dick had thought, you know, he's trying to run both sides of the field. And when him and Buddy Buck had this, it's a tough tough situation, and it's going to happen. You're going to do your side, and he's going to do his, and then we had some people go down, and we had a great player that, you know, had to get his 100 yards. And that's when Jim did come back in the game, instead of playing catch-up. I think it was 1-10 for our offensive linemen, and those guys would give him that 100 yards. He said, we get back to these guys, we'll get back to them. There was a lot of freakish things happen, like with the Richardson, a couple of tips, you know, for touchdowns. Things like that just happen. That's the game of football. But we knew if we got them again, what we would do to them.
When you guys made it to the Super Bowl, was there any question heading into the game that you guys would win?
I don't know. I mean, it was very quiet. Very quiet. I know that I was ready to play. And then it was the funniest thing happened that Walter, I was probably the mistake player, and we all sitting there, and then all you do is heard this music come on, and it was We Are Family. And then the place just went freaking berserk in there, you know. And the guy was ready to play, and all of a sudden we were just worried about everybody just going to, you know, wear themselves down before we got on the field. And it was just so much fun. Got back to the point of being so serious, just, hey, guys, let's get back. Let's have fun. Let's you know, listen to this music. This is how we are, joking around. This is who we are. We enjoy the game. And then we went out there, and we just laid it on the New England.
The hit I remember you for was that one at Joe Ferguson where you knocked him out. I mean, that hit had to be one of the most ferocious I ever saw it.
It was just a bad play for Detroit. You know, wasn't nothing meant to happen. Just ran into it. I mean, I'm got a 20-yard start. He's rolling out. If you're a left-handed quarterback, you don't roll out to your left because you got to bring your shoulder square. And he's left himself vulnerable when I came through, and that was it. Because then he tried to jump, so he really had no leverage. And then when I got him, caught him in the chest, you know, that was it. It was over then.
What I find amazing is the NFL marketed that play for years, and all of a sudden, it's like it never happened. That video disappeared.
Yeah, because of the injuries, I guess, concussion that he had, you know, head injuries. They now, all of those things, all the hits that I got, they basically took off because they were vicious hits. And now with the concussions and everything else that's going on, that they did not want to show that. They don't want to show it. They even took it off the site, you know.
So which did you enjoy?
It was a clean hit.
Yeah. So which did you enjoy more, the fumble return for the touchdown?
I mean, all of it was exciting. The fumble recovery was something that just happened. It was grew up and, you know, snow. And my biggest thing, my thing, it was freezing. I was like, man, I'm glad this thing was over after we scored. I sat on the sidelines and said, guys, just run this thing out. You know,
I think what was funny about that return for the touchdown was it starts snowing when you're returning the ball.
Oh yeah, it was just crazy. You know, everybody was having a good time. You're up, and you know, we was talking a lot of crap. They were too. You know, they always saying a word. We do that now. And then they go back at us, and all you do is just totally pump us up. And we're ready to come get you. You know, our defense was like, you know, we didn't care with McMichaels. You know, man. Blood, you know, just taking it and blood it on his face, and you know, like an Indian, he had it going, man. It was just crazy, man. It was just crazy, but he had so much fun.
Was it frustrating for you in that defense at 46 that Buddy didn't let you rush the passer as much as like the Giants did with Lawrence Taylor? Because you probably could have put up double digit sack years every year.
Well, the difference is that, you know, you got to be a team player and you play what we play. And the difference with that, you know, a lot of guys always bring it up, and they go, well, we played a 3-4. They played a 3-4. They got three linemen, and they got four linebackers. And basically all Lawrence Taylor was is a rush defensive end. He rushed every down. So if you take your defense and you slide them to one side, that's basically what it is. And what we did was we had four linemen and three linebackers, so we had two people off the ball. And that's why we can get to our eight-man front by bringing the safety up, and we have two middle linemen, we go to a 5-2 when we bring the safety up. So if you don't really know the defense, like some of these reporters and people who go to Hall of Fame and do all this stuff, you don't know what it takes to play that defense, you'll never understand it. You'll never understand it because no one else can play it. And by doing it the way we did it, where they can isolate me on a tight end one-on-one, okay, and then what you can do with Fresh Otis, by doing that, we keep the safety in up, and now you can play on both of your wideouts. We can double both of those guys. You see, now everybody playing man-to-man. We can double the corner and safety, and the safety and the strong safety in the other corner. You can double your both receivers, and then your two backs. You got Otis and you got Mike. So they don't have enough people to block you. That's why they brought everybody in. But now they spread this thing out. We wouldn't allow that.
What I think. What I think is interesting too is everybody says Singletary. Singletary did not play every down. They would put you in the middle on passing downs because you were a better pass defender than Singletary.
Because we can still run the same thing out of it because I still play like corner and safety because they put me on the wide out for one-on-one. But if you don't know the defense, like I said before, we can go up and line up and they should call it to down, they try to call a Tampa to line you up on the receiver. I just have to know where my holes are because I know that when we line up in that, that I can't get in the middle because in the two, you have two deep. Anything in the middle or in the post corner that they can get. So you have to know exactly what you're doing when you're playing back there, not just sitting up on the line just playing a run. You know, you got to be able to do that, and that's what helped our defense. Where we can still run those, you know, nickels and dimes out of regular people. And like I said, if the other reporters and people that do all the voting and all of those stuff, if they knew exactly how the defense run and how what's the difference between the 3-4 and the 4-3, then you realize how much I did.
There's not that many 4-3 outside linebackers in the Hall of Fame.
No, it's only I think it's two, actually. Ben Brooks just got in, and I know my numbers are better than his. But you know that's what they want in his era. If you're on a losing team, you got to get a lot of numbers. But we wasn't. Every team that I played on was very good teams, and if you're not on the field, you can't pull the numbers. But and then the other one, I think I'm not sure, but I think Ham may have played a little bit 3-4 to 4-3, depending on could they switch back and forth. But usually when they do that, like I said, Pro Bowls and voting, there is no outside linebacker. So it's hard on me getting to that point and giving me the accolades because they don't vote that way. They want the rush linebacker or a defensive end that they call, you mean the 3-4, like Lawrence Taylor, or the guy from Green Bay that you see there.
Clay Matthews.
That's coming off coming off the corner, but you don't ask him to cover a receiver or a back, or if he has to play behind the line of scrimmage and play the run. So knowing which way to play a counter trade, come across, there's a lot of stuff that those guys, if you put them back there, like Derek Brooks, they tried that to move him back once, you know, from Kansas City. Couldn't do it. They had to put him back on line cuffs here, especially if just coming off the corner because it's deep. You don't have to think to play that game on the outside in the 3-4. You just line up and you just rush.
Yeah. Speaking of numbers, in 86 you had 5 interceptions, 5.5 sacks, named first team All-Pro for the first time, but the team was unable to repeat. What happened that season?
Well, that's only we switched coaches, you know. Buddy went off, and everything that Tobin wanted to do, he wanted to change. It was almost, okay, we don't want that identity. We don't want to call those plays. We don't want that, you know. This is my team. You know, if it's not the old saying, if it's not broke, don't fix it.
Yeah.
And what he wanted to do was something totally different. He tried to work some of the plays in and play basic. Our game was basically surprise and change. And we can't, you know, move the line and change it when we're playing something vanilla. So it was tough to go back and do that. So if you do that and you're on the field a very long time, it's tough.
I heard that he didn't understand the 46. That was part of the problem.
Yeah, it was tough. A lot of the players, and they wanted the defensive line coach, basically, we thought they should have gotten that job. I think a lot of people thought that that's who should have had that job, that could still run the same defense. You know, you always bring up the guy beneath you if he goes, because none of those guys left. Most of those guys stayed with the Bears. So we could have kept running it. They didn't go, buddy. They stayed there. So it was really awkward. And the players, you know, some of the players resented it. And I know that sometimes, you know, we have to make changes. But we figured that we can do this if we can do it on our own. Because most of us knew exactly how to make the plays, because Buddy was on the field, the defensive line coach and the defensive back coach. All those guys were up in the stand. They were the one who was making the call. So we knew that he could be a great coach, and that didn't happen. It kind of threw everything off.
When did the tension or the fighting between Buddy and Ditka start? Did it start during that Miami game or before that?
All way before that. All that happened before they, I guess, my understanding of history is that when Papa Bear gave half the team to Buddy and half team to Dick, and it just was a tough situation, and getting players to line up. And Buddy, that's why Buddy was a great coach. He knew how to motivate his boys and get them to play, and they could, you know, whatever you want to do on that side. Buddy was always saying, hey, we'll score on this side. It didn't matter. We'll score the points. We'll play defense and we'll score. And most of the time, that's what we did.
Now, after the 87 season, you became a free agent and you got an offer from Washington. Were you expecting the Bears? Were you expecting the Bears to match that offer, or were you pretty sure you were gone?
I was pretty sure I was going. I knew I was going the year that we lost to the Redskins, that I was going. So that's another story. But
I remember you telling me about that before. I mean, because you basically had that deal pretty much struck during the strike.
Yeah, pretty much. Things was done. It was on the ball, and couldn't do anything until afterwards. But you know, McCaskey done didn't give a darn, you know. If they did, we could have had a deal done before the end of the season. All they cared about is, you know, we can control you. This is our team. You can't go anywhere. This is what they told me. You know, we're going to do what we're going to do. And that's fine. I got smart people working for me, too.
Because wasn't Jack Kent Cook personally recruiting you during the strike?
No, I wasn't recruiting.
Or not recruiting, but basically trying to talk to you and say, listen, I think you should come to Washington?
No, when the deal happened, what was going on, my agent knew some people that know some people. It just kind of went that way. I didn't know anything about the deal until my agent came out with me. So it wasn't no one was recruiting or making a run for anybody.
But then when you were a free agent, Miami kind of winded, or not Miami, Washington kind of winded and dined you, right?
Washington had a what?
The Washington kind of wined and dined you. Didn't they fly you on a private plane there and you met with the owner?
Yeah, they didn't wind. Well, I wouldn't say wind and dine. I mean, at the time that I came in, it was during the strike time, there was no agreement. I went in with my agent, and that's when I met them. And everybody knew I was in town, what I was doing, and it just happened, you know. And then when we got the agreement, then, you know, you can't talk to anybody, you can't do anything. And then at the time, the bargaining agreement still wasn't struck. So we were basically, there was no union, there was no, nothing. So we were allowed to do whatever we wanted to do at that time.
Right, you know, it was all on the up and up. You followed the rules, but again, Washington basically showed how much they wanted you. And McCaskey, what, he met with you and he had you, like, come in his office for ham and cheese sandwich and tried to offer you a deal?
Who? No, that's what the Bears.
Yeah, the Bears, Mike McCaskey.
No, he didn't do that. He asked me, I came to towards the end of the year and came and told me to come meet him up in the office, and, you know, it was just some sandwich and some soup, whatever. I thought, you know, we were going to talk about something. eventually he's letting me, you know, our property, and we can do this and that you can do about it. So I went along quietly, finished out my year, and when it hit them, they still thought they had it. I kind of talked to Tobin and those guys, and said, well, fine, and shook their hands. Most of the guys at the end of that last game, the Redskins, they shook their hands, hey, guys, see you. And a lot of people were like, what are you talking about? I said, I'm not here. I'm gone. And I knew it, because I knew they wouldn't be able to match what they were going to put up.
And the Bears had a lot more money available because Peyton was retiring after that Washington game.
Well, we had no salary cap. They could have paid whatever they want to, just like when they brought me in before. And what I was asking for wasn't maybe $1 million more than what I was making. And you spread that out in so many years, 5 years, that wasn't hardly anything. And then that's when the other side said, hey, we'll give you this. I was like, wow, you know, what was I supposed to do?
Yeah.
You know, take that, and that's what I did.
What was the transition like joining Washington and fitting in with the defense there?
It was difficult being the first person to ever do it, you know, for a long period of time, trying to fit in with it. They just won the Super Bowl, and they beat us, you know, and making that kind of money. Being the first person to do that, and you know, they expect, and especially the other player, they expected a hell of a lot out of you. And it was very stressful for, you know, the first year or two, and finally guys got to know that, you know, I'm giving my all, just like how I did with the other team, and made some good friends, and then they realized that, you know, all you want to do is win. And that's what we did. Went to the playoffs. You got three out of the 5 years. I went there, and four with the Redskins. I've been in the playoffs for 8 times. Why you with these Noles? That's 8 playoff appearances.
I think
they did well.
What was Gibbs like as a coach?
Who?
What was Joe Gibbs like as a coach?
Oh, he was quiet. You know, he had his boys, people that he voted that he brought in. And that's just how it was. He just had to fit in his way, you know, very religious person. He wanted things to be done like he wanted to do, and not like the crazy guys that we had, you know, everything's holding them down. Everybody's going to, you know, go to church, go to Bible study, and do all that stuff compared to where I came from. We knew that stuff. We didn't have to go to do all those meetings, and, you know, you just came in, you studied. Everybody lived their own life and did what they did in Chicago, but there, it was different.
Was the fan expectation pretty high considering you came in with a big contract and all that?
The fan loved it. They did basically the same thing. Why are you not letting him rush? Put him on the line and let him go. You got him sitting back there. And I played, and like I said, that team played a 4-3-2, but didn't rush that back. I was off the ball most of my career. So it wasn't only when they called a blitz, I went to it. So they got to the point where, you know, the fans was calling, you know, why are you not doing it? Why are you not using them, using like the Bears? You got them here, you use them. Finally, by that second, third year, they start bringing me up and letting me play a lot more, coming off the corner a little bit more because Dexter was getting hurt or going through his problems. They just start falling into place. I start making plays, interceptions, and whatever. They couldn't get me off the field. So that's just how it turned out.
What was that Super Bowl like with the Redskins compared to the one with the Bears?
Well, nothing's going to be compared to the first one you go to. I guess anybody would tell you that. Nothing, you know, getting to that point is unbelievable. And being with the Redskins, it was totally different, too, going there, especially playing in Minnesota. you didn't expect that one. It's freezing cold and over the indoors, but you had all the different stuff in New Orleans, you know, to do and be outside. But Minnesota was just totally the worst place you could have been at that time. You know, guys were ice fishing. So you can imagine how exciting that was. I go to the mall, indoor mall, you know, that's about all you can do.
a dream come true.
Yeah. So, you know, I had a good time. But it was good. You got to meet a lot of good people. But, you know, when you have more activities, you know, I think, you know, you would like it a lot more better. But at that time, snow. And, you know, you said ice fishing. Most of you guys had events like that. I stayed there. I'm like, this is not good. But, you know, when you win it and you carry it, you know, that ring, there's nothing like it.
What was it like hooking up again with Buddy Ryan when he was with the Houston Oilers?
Oh, it was good. We had a good time, get a chance to play. But I got hurt, like, golly, when I came in doing practice. Buddy had a fit that the coach ended up putting me on special teams. And I got knees right above my knee in that sack. And it just totally blew up. And I had to get surgery. So it was just really bad situation at that time. They're like, why do you pay this man all this money? We brought him in here to do this, and then you put him on this crap and you get him hurt? No. What in the heck are we going to do? And, you know, stuff that I could do. I mean, I had it trained and surgery and, you know, went through the whole thing. And I think it was Jack Part. Jack Pardee was the head coach then, something like that.
Yeah, that was the... There was a year that Buddy had the famous incident on the sidelines with Kevin Gilbert.
Yeah. That was a good team. We won the AFC division that year. I got back like the 10th, I think it was the 9th or the 10th game. And we had a good squad. Just got, you know, at the very end, that one playoff game, got knocked out. So, you know, got lucky.
How hard was it on you that game when Frank Reich beat you guys?
Oh, it was tough. A lot of guys, you know, the great guys that we played with, but didn't have that killer instinct. And that's all I saw. They had great talent, you know. It was just difficult to see that, you know. I think that's why Buddy wanted me there to be there and talk to these guys. And, you know, you're just right there on the cusp for this, like, you know, they just couldn't get over that hump. Almost like Buffalo, same thing. All this talent, you win all these freaking games, you get to that big one, all it takes is that one person or on the east side of the ball, you know, have been there. And wanted to let them know how important it was. And just being hurt and not being able to, you know, mingle with the guys and be a part of the guys and you know, get that heartbeat. And if everybody's working on that same one, then you know you're going to win.
Now, when Buddy went to Arizona, you got to play for him there, too. What was that experience? Yeah. What was that like?
Oh, it was tough. It was tough because that team never won. He was trying to breed, you know, some great athletes they had there. It was great, but, you know, mental, like I said, at the time, I know from going to a winning team to someone who couldn't win. It was just they had their own way. They wanted to do their own thing, and it was very tough to get everybody on the same page, and he had a short amount of time to do it. And he had a great, like I said, he had great athletes there. It's just that you got to buy into what the coach is doing. If you don't do that and you make the mistakes, and like I told you when I played with the Bears, everybody had to know everybody's position, and it wasn't that way there. And you can tell the mistakes in the film room that, you know, the lineman, he had guys to come off the street to play. You know, he was trying to get it together, and he almost did. He almost did before they, you know, decided, you know, we gave you these years and it didn't happen. Well, shit, you gave you the worst team. It's going to be tough.
It seems like to this day, this 46 defense still works. It doesn't seem it could be, if you get the right players, the offenses could break it down. Is that true?
No. The right players, come on, the offense can break down that defense?
I don't think offensive players can break down that defense if it's run right.
No, because of the way we play it, you put your quarterbacks in harm way, the way you play it. We made teams adjust, bring in two tight ends like the Redskins did, you know, bring your fullback in, you got to bring everybody in the block to protect them. See, we can come off the corner. We made people that spread out. We made them bring guys in, You didn't want to do this run and shoot and what they're doing now, this West Coast stuff, because you can hurt your quarterback. You know, we line up, it's just like Mike Singletary, you got a five-man line, we got five, basically, you can put the eye over the nose, two guards, and you got two ends. With two linebackers, you're not enough people to block everybody. You know, I don't care how fast you can get the ball, and he can't even back up three steps when you got Dan Hampton over the nose pushing that center back and telling him he ain't got time to think to throw the ball. So the way we did it, like I said before, was that they can single up me on the tight end, bring them in, even they leave them on, then they can double everybody. If they ain't got enough time to throw the ball, not when we got that many, we outnumber you. There's no way it's going to happen. But no one else knew how to play it. So they always brought up a safety to play over the tight end instead of having a linebacker like myself to play over that can rush and can cover. And by doing that, we can disguise it. We can run zone out of it. We can, you know, there's different things that we could have done out of it that none of the other guys decided to do that. When you play a safety, you bring a safety down that tells the quarterback that exactly what you're about to run. But when we use regular people, he didn't know. We could run anything off of it.
I listened to you break down the offense and the defense. Why aren't you coaching?
Oh, no. No.
It pays better than it used to.
There's a stress. There's a stress for me. It's hard for me to even watch the games now. I watched a little bit. I watched the Bears a little bit the other day. It's frustrating if I don't see somebody still in the right hole, dropping in the right zone. You know, I get stressful, and I can see what these coaches go through, what they go through. It's very difficult.
It's hard watching today's game compared to when you played and before, because it's almost like arena football now. It's all offense, and they're protecting these offensive players so much. It's not fun to watch at times.
Well, the point is to score points. That's what they want to see, all the great catches and the deep passes, everything quick. Scoring point was a thing, but you know, when you wanted to go see a great team, you go watch the Bears, that you don't dominate, eat anybody up. You know, it's like, man, I want to see what they're going to do next. We got to line them up. You know, they're going to be some hell of a collision. We got to knock some people out, and that's how we talk on the sideline. Okay, guys, who's going to get it today? You know, it was fun to see who's going to knock somebody out.
I mean, yeah, you had that Raiders game, I think, in 84, when you knocked out with David Hulme, Rusty Hilger, I think Mark Wilson. They were out of quarterbacks.
Yeah, that's what we did. We always called, hey, bring the next one on. We're going to see how good he is. And by doing that, you know, and then you get your stats. So you just slow it down. And like I said, it was tough for us to get all the stats, even though, you know, I got quite a few. But it's like when you get off and you have walk on that other side and them, you know, running it, you used to get mad at them. Hey, guys, let us on the field. You know, we want to get some stats. We're fighting over sacks. Because, you know, we didn't have that much time to get them. Because at any time we would get a sack or running one in for a touchdown, and the best part of it is if we can get ahead, then we knew that we can get a stat, because we knew they got to get out of the game plan, and we can layer his back and make something happen.
You're in the College Football Hall of Fame. You're in the University of Florida Ring of Honor. We're named to the Washington 70th anniversary team. What's it like?
Yeah, a lot of different things.
Yeah. How gratifying is that?
Oh, it's great. I mean, especially the University of Florida getting my chance. I love the University of Florida. Both of my girls go to school there, graduate from there, nursing, and I got one just getting out of speech pathologist, and I'm so proud of them and the opportunity that they have and what the school did for us. It's incredible. And all the other awards, you know, came along with the way I played and the coaches that I had, you know, they really helped me out. And I guess it's just like one missing, but I don't know. I can't understand what's going on with the voting process, but that's just, I guess, how it goes.
It's all political now. You should be in, but it seems like that unless you are part of ESPN after your career or Fox Sports, where they're, or CBS, where they're promoting you, it's hard for these guys to get in.
Yeah, that's true. It's tough, but, you know, I thought that if you just kept your head down and not being in the public eye or being in the White House, we call the White House scandal in Texas, or you know, beating someone or being on the 700 Club or you name it, all of a sudden you talk about the moral police and then they, you know, have those same guys that are on their show. And all I can do is play as hard as I could, and I know a lot of fans wondering why, what's going on, and I can honestly tell them I don't know. They always say they look at the records. You can pull up their books that just got in. My numbers are better than his. My numbers are better than the other records. You pull the numbers up, but they're going to get it. That's just what they wanted. That's the face. That's the people that they use, and I can go on. Mike Singletary, my number's better than Mike's. But the Pro Bowl, when you're picking that, I think maybe that's what hurts me because I wouldn't have rushed outside linebacker to get the sacks. I was a guy that played and got the interception, the turnovers, the hits. And the press, all they want to see is those numbers are sacks instead of what that guy does for that team. If they go back and look at that, then they have a better chance to evaluate it better.
No, you're absolutely right, because I was looking at the list of linebackers in the Hall of Fame. 85% of them are middle linebackers, and then the rest are pretty much outside rush linebackers. The only ones
call them what they are, the defensive end in a 3-4. The one guy always rushes. If you rush more than 90% of the time, you got his hand on the ground, they're standing up. He's not an outside linebacker. He doesn't cover anybody.
Right. The only ones I saw that weren't looked like Ted Hendricks, like you said, Jack Ham, and that's pretty much it.
Yeah, Hendrick played in the middle, too. So, and Ham did a little both, but look what he had playing in front of him. nobody will touch him with the steel curtain, you know. But
yeah, when you have Mean Joe Green, you have L.C. Greenwood and those guys, yeah. It makes it easier.
Yeah. And make it happy, so we did, you know, we're all thankful that we did get two of them in there because I think you should have even gotten McMichael. So, you know, we got some other ball players I thought should be on that team, should be in there.
McMichael's on the list this year. He's one of the, whatever they call it, semifinalists. I saw him on
there. That's good. Well, you know, you got a team you consider one of the greats, and you don't even have all the, you know, like Green Bay, like the, so you don't have the players, you know, in, so it's tough.
I'll tell you what, I'll really be pissed off if they put Cornelius Bennett in before you.
Well, he's a defensive, like I said, he's a best linebacker, right. And he's on the losing team 4 times in the Super Bowl. That's all that matters, out there. Not that you won it. That's just, I don't know, that's just how it is. Maybe I stepped on too many toes, making an issue on making it right for all the other players, that all the players think that it should be done some other way. I don't know.